Hey, happy Thursday, everybody. Mark again here, Weatherman. Plus, I got a big update on what's going on with Hurricane Helene, plus what is coming around the corner, still showing we have two potential waves that could be forming up. Now, actually, this invest in the Northern Atlantic has taken the name Isaac. That is moving further towards east. The invest down here in the MDR is having issues getting a center of circulation, but if it does form, it will be Joyce. If it does not form, this big tropical wave that's potentially the one that's going to be the next major moving over the Caribbean could pick up some remnants of this as it continues to track west, northwest, and showing a lot of strength. So the Eastern Caribbean definitely should be on the lookout for that. And we still have this sneaky wave that's moving across, still showing anywhere from 7 to 8 days. And we could have something form up either in the Western Gulf or the Eastern Gulf. It could affect Texas or Louisiana or Florida. Now, latest update this morning is actually some good news. It's still going to be a very big and large system, still moving fast to the north. And that's what's bringing all this storm surge is up to 20 feet. Now, chances for the storm surge, it is going to be a fast mover. A big, broad system will bring a lot of surge, regardless of whether it's a 3 or 4. Now, it's expected to strengthen up as it goes by later for this afternoon. 115 miles per hour, sustained winds, 138 wind gusts. That would put it officially as a major hurricane. And I'm still showing on the track intensity guidance that it might be on a low grade Cat 3, rather a Cat 2. So there's a little bit of discrepancy there as well. Still showing it will go up towards a Cat 1 hurricane as it goes on landfall. You remember when they have this fast forward motion, it takes a while for these big and broad systems to wind down and lose your strength. Showing southern Georgia, you will be somewhere around 86 miles per hour sustained winds, 109 miles per hour wind gusts. Still a very powerful hurricane. So in my opinion, do not knock prayers. If you haven't, matter of fact, go drop to your knees and pray to God to weaken this storm some more, because there's still some very catastrophic flooding and some very strong winds coming with this system. It's still a powerful hurricane, even though it's just showing some people it's just a major. That's a pretty big deal. Once it goes past a Cat 2, it's just really bad impacts, and it's just worse winds as you come on shore. The flooding's still going to be there. Matter of fact, as it goes up towards the Appalachians, what you need to watch out for is your higher elevations. Now, the rainfall amounts has come down. That's a good thing. But you being in the higher elevations, you're going to get stronger wind gusts as this system moves to the north. Remember that as well. But you can also see for Helene, it is at 90 miles per hour moving north-northeast now. And it's moving fast. It's moving fast at 12 miles per hour. So it's starting to feel that tug from that trough. Now remember, that trough is going to help it breathe, help it so it will continue to strengthen towards landfall still. But that tug is going to make this speed up even faster. This is going to come on shore very quickly. Now, once it comes on shore for Thursday, remember by Friday, it's still going to be over here in Tennessee, but you're still going to get some of that storm surge afterwards. But look at this. Latest intensity guidance takes it way down to where it's going to be anywhere from a strong Cat 1 to a low-end Cat 3. So you still could get what I originally said in the beginning. It still could be a strong Cat 2 at landfall. So we will see. We'll see how the hurricane models take the new information and update. So far, it is still showing right at landfall. It will still strengthen right towards a Cat 4, bringing 131 miles per hour sustained winds, bringing 155 miles per hour wind gusts. Still showing it will bring a lot of wind gusts as it goes by for this afternoon right around the Tampa region. Now, what you got to remember, if this wobbles west or east, this is where it does that wobble. The trend is, after it heads north, it slowly will start drifting to the east. So this either is going to go towards Tallahassee, bring them a catastrophic potential major hurricane, which is something they never had before. It has a lot of trees over there. It'd be a lot of power outages. Northern Florida, southern Georgia, a lot of trees, a lot of power outages. If it wiggles to the east, this will bring more impacts towards Tampa and the Big Bend area. Now, this run, it shows that it will go back to the west a little bit and bring a lot of the wind gusts. Look, everyone is covered in the high 60s all across Florida, southern Georgia, even getting 70s all across into the Atlantic. It's a very big and broad system. Still showing it will go into southern Georgia, bringing over 115 miles per hour wind gusts by tonight. Now, if you go by tonight, overnight into the morning, over 100 miles per hour wind gusts headed north still, going to Tennessee, Kentucky, Virginia, Illinois, Indiana by tomorrow evening. Just a very powerful storm still, even though it's not showing that for. Like I said before, once it hits that major hurricane status, it's just so strong at that point. Any strength is just putting salt on the wound. It's just bad enough. Matter of fact, Hurricane Analysis Forecast System B strengthens it still to 140 sustained winds. So we will see what the update is on those models with the newer information and bring it over 160 miles per hour wind gusts, showing a little bit worse case of a scenario for everyone in the track. Storm surge is almost about the same as I said in last night's video. The only difference is there is a slight area right here by the Big Bend where instead of 10 to 15 feet or even 10 to 18 feet, or now they brought it to 15 to 20 feet in that region. So that's just ridiculous. Just imagine a basketball goal that's 10 feet, double that. That's how deep this water is going to be. Rainfall amounts is still a lot, but you can see how much it has come down greatly. You're not seeing the 20 inches. You barely even have the high risk over here and the higher elevations of Western North Carolina. You got to watch out. You're in the higher elevations. You're going to feel the impacts from this storm. Just like if it's a tropical storm, you're going to feel like it's a hurricane just because you're in a higher elevation, stronger winds, a lot more rainfall. You're still getting that 12 to 16 in that red. Has come down greatly, and it could come down even more. Remember, this system is going to be a fast-moving system. Only problem is that after it does that Fujiwara effect and it gets together, it's going to bring a bad flooding event for y'all over here by the Tennessee-Kentucky Valley, I do believe. You still have it from the 8 to the 12 inches in that darker orange right there. Also, you still have some right here for the Florida Panhandle. Mostly everyone's in that 1 to 2 in a light green, 2 to 4 in a dark green, and you got 4 to 6 inches in all of this yellow still. The flash flooding has gone up. Not only the high risk over here, you have the higher risk right at landfall as well. And you still have the moderate level and a big slight risk going on. Your tornadoes for today is almost about the same, but the 10% risk has grown more in South Carolina and more towards Jacksonville in Florida. So here's your cities and states at risk within a 25-mile point of the tornado risk for today. National Weather Service has several tornadoes will be possible later today into tonight in association with Hurricane Helene. The greatest threat is expected from parts of Florida into southeast Georgia, the Midlands and Low Country of South Carolina and southern North Carolina. Plus, I'm still showing over on Colorado State University that this is all going to get upgraded even more. Plus, as we go through Friday, and this moves up over here by northern Georgia into Tennessee, over here on the eastern side of it, where you're going to get all the feeder bands, this is where it's going to be bad for you. So the tornado chances for Friday, the 2% and the 5%, here's your cities and states at risk within a 25-mile point. So far, showing the tropical wave that's going across into the Gulf, into the Western Caribbean, will pile up somewheres around the southern Gulf of Mexico. This is where it could form up somewheres on the western Gulf, or get pulled back towards the eastern Gulf. And you can see that next wave starting to come forward into the Caribbean. You can also see here that as we go 4 or 5 days, the invest over in the NBR dies off, and that wave that comes off the coast of Africa comes in and eats whatever that has left. We have something trying to form up in the Gulf of Mexico. Could go out into the eastern Pacific, but it is balling up over here while this wave moves west, northwest, showing this could head north towards Texas and Louisiana, and this could start strengthening right towards the Lesser Antilles. Still up in the air what is going to happen on the latest run. GFS is taking it from October 3rd, form up in the Gulf, still bringing a storm maybe towards southern Florida. Maybe it won't have time to form up real strong. Also showing that wave come off the NVR could get pulled up by that invest out there trying to head north. It could mess up the track of that, but it still tries to continue to head west as a very strong major hurricane. And that would satisfy all that lift that I see on the data. Now, when you go by the Ural takes that further to the west, still showing a curve, but it shows the one in the Gulf could actually form up into something. You see how that still shows a curve, still showing a strong hurricane, but then it curves away. Potentially could come back later on. We got to watch it. But the one in the Gulf shows that it could strengthen up, and then it could weaken after that. So there's a lot of different information popping around these two waves. We have to keep our eye on them. And that is all that lift that we see right here, according to the Euro, was coming around the corner. After that passes, I'm still showing once we go around the 10th of October and the rest of October, potentially going through a weak phase where there's sinking air moving through and it don't have a lot of favor and atmosphere for anything to grow. You see, we still have some that do try. But once we go towards the very end of October into November, it could pick right back up again. Now, I'm going to do an early afternoon update for today so you can get the latest information before this comes any closer towards landfall for this evening. And it'll be pretty much the last update before you might start losing your power. It is expected to go out. Just be aware of that. Once the tropical storm force winds, once it starts getting to 40 miles per hour sustained winds out there, DeSantis is going to call back all the workers, all the frontline workers. They got to get away for their safety, and there's no more work that's going to be done on your power until those winds calm back down. So remember that as well. Thank you for your time, everybody. My heart and my prayers go out to every single one of you. I hope you will be okay. Remember, the afternoon update will come this afternoon. Hopefully, we see a weakness in the forecast. This is a pretty big thing that is starting off a little weaker than expected. Still, it's expected to intensify. We will see what comes out of it. I'm still praying to God that he puts his finger on this and weakens this, but still, whatever his will is, be done, not ours. All we can do is pray for the best. Now, before you go, a little something to think about. Everyone, or a lot of people, knows that when Jesus was crucified, when he gave up the ghost, we had the earthquake. A lot of things broke. A lot of things cracked. Darkness for hours. People know this. What people don't know is actually it raised up the dead as well. As soon as he let go of his ghost, the power just expanded. Look at this. Matthew 27, 50 through 53. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielding up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And the earth did quake and the rocks rent. And remember, when that veil is shredded, that means that you have a direct connection straight you to God. You don't need to go to someone else to speak for you. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. Amen. A lot of people don't know that. It's not just Jesus was crucified and he let go of the ghost and he left. Even some people know about the earthquake. There was so many things that happened when he went. They can even backtrack the eclipse that happened on his death because it was dark for hours, 3 or 4 hours. It was dark. And dead people arose. Dead people arose and walked into the city. You don't hear a lot about that. Remember, all glory goes to God, our Father in heaven, Yahweh. And I always hope he keeps you safe every single day of your life. And forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It would do a lot of good if a lot of people would drop to their knees, find a private, quiet place, give a personal relationship with God, and pray to him. Pray to him for mercy. Why would he not answer? Would not a dad or a mom answer a kid's wishes? If they really were truly, wholeheartedly wanted something, wouldn't they get it for them? Your father is not any different. He would help you if you would just reach out and cry to him with faith. Everyone in this whole generation is so high-minded and rebellious, and it's not good. I'll see you all this afternoon. May God always be with all of you.